Good morning. It was a year ago today that Mike Rittering was suddenly taken from us and ushered into the presence of Jesus Christ. If you're new to our church and for some reason Mike and his story eludes you, Mike was a part of our church, part of our leadership team, part of our elder board, before what God called he and Amy to Africa. And a year ago today, Mike was killed in a terrorist attack in Ouagadougou, Burkina Faso. I must confess that there are days that I still struggle with his death. If you knew Mike, you probably feel much like I do. I want to make some sense of it. I really want God to give me a plausible reason as to why he took Mike home so early. Of course, as I've thought through that phrase and prayed through that phrase, even the last couple of days, I realized that God doesn't owe me any explanation. And God doesn't owe you any explanation. His way, his purposes, and God's plans are always perfect. Mike's life, though, still speaks to me. As a matter of fact, I have Mike's picture in my office. If you were here last year, you remember this. This sits in my office. Every single morning when I walk in my office, Mike is there with me. And Mike is kind of looking over me 24/7, kind of making sure that I do my job. Sometimes I think that Mike, in Mike's own humor, would sit back and giggle with that. You know, that he's watching over me all of the time. Even as I watched that video again, and I know we've played that video several times. That video was done by a man named Tremaine, who was in St. Louis. And even as I watched the video of Mike preaching this morning, my heart was convicted. And yes, I believe that Mike speaks to me, and his message still speaks even from the grave. Let me tell you what I mean just a little bit. Because of my heart condition, I don't mean necessarily my spiritual heart condition, but those that know me know that I've had several heart attacks, and the doctors are working with me. Because of my heart condition, I have always been fearful to travel to Burkina Faso. And the 6 years that I've been pastor here, Mike was constantly bugging me. He was constantly pushing me. He wanted me to travel to Burkina Faso. And as only Mike could, he teased me about that fear. From Africa, he would text me pictures of the hospital there in Yako, poking fun of my fear to travel to Africa. He would send me a picture and say, "Brian, just by the way, if you ever have problems while you're here, here's the hospital we'll take you to." That was Mike. You might sit back and say, "Well, that was cruel," but that was Mike. That was Mike's humor. Quite frankly, I wish so badly that I could have made the trip while Mike was alive. I'm thrilled to report, though, that 2 months from today, 2 months from this very Sunday, I, along with 6 other members of our congregation, will be in Yako, Burkina Faso, and visiting the ministry that's there. So I know Mike probably is looking down over the portals of heaven in our service today. And Mike, I want you to know I'm going. I wish I would have gone while you were there, but I'm going, and I'm so anxious to see how God used Mike and how God continues to use Amy there and the team in Burkina Faso. And we'll say more about that team in just a little bit and or in a couple of weeks, and we'll have a prayer dedication for us before we go. Mike's life verse was Philippians chapter 1 and verse 21. He quoted it in the video just a few moments ago, and the verse many of you are familiar with. The verse very simply goes like this: "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Would you say that with me today? I think most of you know that. It's not long. Would you say that verse with me today if you can? "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." In the video that you just watched, Mike made a powerful statement and then followed that statement with a penetrating question. Mike made this statement, almost prophetically made this statement. If we lost everything, even our own lives, we have gained everything in heaven. That is something to look forward to. Can you live your life like that? Mike lived his life like that. It wasn't just a verse that Mike quoted. It was something that was real to him. That question springs from Mike's life. But it not only springs from Mike's life, but that question is addressed in the passage of Scripture that I want us to look at today, in the passage of Scripture that I want us to flesh out. And so if you have your Bibles today, if you have your iPhone, your iPad, whatever you're using, turn with me to Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1, and we'll put the verses up on the screen so you can follow along. Philippians chapter 1, we're going to read a little bit of a lengthy passage, but we want to look at it and flesh it out today. Philippians chapter 1, beginning in verse 19. These obviously are the words of the Apostle Paul as he sat in a Roman prison and he wrote the church of Philippi, challenging them and, of course, challenging us as his words transcend time and transcend generation after generation, speaking to us. Philippians 1:19, Paul says, "For I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance." Verse 20, "As it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be at all ashamed, but that with full courage, now as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by life or by death." Verse 21, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Pause there for just a second. If you were stating those words, what would be the word that you would put after the word "is"? For me to live is. What would you say today? For me to live is, you know, success. For me to live is my family. For me to live is whatever. Put that there. For Paul said, for me to live is Jesus Christ. And then he added that caveat at the end, and to die is gain. Verse 22, "If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Yet which I shall choose, I cannot tell. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your accounts. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith, so that in me you may have ample cause to glory in Christ Jesus because of my coming to you again." Notice verse 27, Paul says, "Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come to see you or am absent, I may hear of you that you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel." Would you pray with me today? Lord, thank you so much for the privilege that we have to meet together as your children, as a faith family this morning. Father, thank you that we can lift our voices and cry out to you, knowing, as Dr. Hill said, that you are a good God who is for us. Lord, you're not only the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, but you are our Savior. You are our friend. You desire to have a personal relationship with us. You take interest in each and every one of us. We thank you for that this morning. And so now, Lord, as we remember Mike, and even more importantly, Lord, as we look at your word today, Father, I pray that you would use your word to speak to our hearts, just as you use these verses to speak to Mike and Amy. And Father, I pray that our lives would be centered around not ourselves, that our lives would be centered around Jesus Christ and his plan for our lives. And so this morning we thank you for what you're doing in our lives and how you are going to speak to us individually through these verses this morning. And so we promise to give you all the praise and all the honor and all the glory. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the question for us today and the challenge for us today is, how can we, like Mike, live out the truth of these verses? How can Philippians 1:21 be more than just a verse that we quote? How can it truly become the theme, the challenge, the goal of our lives? How can we be like Mike? How can we be like the Apostle Paul? How can we honestly say, for me to live is Jesus Christ, but to die truly is gain? The passage that we're looking at today sheds some light on that. And if you have your outline, kind of follow along with me as we walk through the passage today. The first thing that we see in verse 19 is that you and I can make that statement if we are truly supported by the prayers of the saints. Notice verse 19, Paul says, "For I know that through your prayers." Here's what Paul is saying. Paul does not believe that he alone has the power to survive. Paul is not saying that he alone has the power to minister. Paul realizes that he alone does not have the power, the strength, the capacity to be victorious on his own. Paul desperately needed the prayer partnership of a supporting faith community. As a matter of fact, in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, Paul made this statement. Notice this verse, such a great verse. Paul tells the Corinthians, he says, "You also must help us by prayer, so that many will give thanks on our behalf for the blessing granted us through the prayers of many." Here's what Paul is saying. Paul is saying, listen, I desperately need the prayer supports of others. Quite frankly, of Paul, a hero of the faith, an individual who wrote half the New Testament, if Paul could sit back and honestly say, I desperately need the prayers of others, how much more do I need it? How much more do you need it? Paul realized that the effective prayer of a righteous man, of a righteous woman, can accomplish much. Therefore, he not only diligently interceded for others, but he knew how much he needed the prayers of others. Just a couple of practical things that I didn't put in your notes, but I would say this. How does that apply to us today? Two ways that I think it applies to us. First of all, realizing that Paul was a missionary, much like Mike and Amy were missionaries, we need to pray for our missionaries. We desperately need to pray for our missionaries. Shame on us for not calling out to God on behalf of our missionary families. I hope you realize this, but we have some 25 missionary families that represent us around the world. And day after day, week after week, Sunday after Sunday, they are standing up preaching the gospel, and they not only represent Jesus Christ, but they represent us. Some of them from our church body, many of them are in dangerous places around the world. And our job, our partnership with them is to support them in prayer. We must pray for their safety. We must pray for their needs to be met. We must pray that God gives them courage and strength, even in the most difficult of circumstances. We need to pray for our missionaries. And by the way, if you don't have a list of our missionaries, we can get those to you. I would ask you to have a list of your missionaries, and you put them in your Bible. And when you spend time with God on a regular basis, you call out to God praying for those missionaries. We regularly have lists of our missionaries back at the Welcome Center table. I would encourage you to do that. But here's the second thing that I think we need to realize. Not only do we need to pray for our missionaries, but we need to pray for one another. Thank you so much, Rick. I was hoping somebody would... I started coughing on purpose, just so hoping somebody would bring me water in just a few moments, huh? Thank you. Rick had that in his back pocket, by the way, and just pulled it out of his back pocket. Huh? We need to pray for one another. Quite frankly, and I don't mean to be overly critical today, and I'm going to get really positive today, but quite frankly, sometimes I wonder if we really believe that prayer works. Here's what I mean. We talk about it a lot, But as evangelical Christians, I'm afraid that often we talk more about prayer than we really pray. We know the verses, we know what the Bible says. If I asked you today, do you believe that prayer works? Your answer would be, amen, Pastor Brian. I believe that prayer really works. And yet the busyness of our lives and the busyness of our schedules keep us from really crying out to God in prayer. Sometimes I wonder if we really believe that prayer works, would we not pray more? I ask the question this way. What if we really prayed for one another? I mean, seriously, what if we truly prayed for one another? What if you had this prayer list in which you regularly called out to God on a regular basis for your family, your friends, your acquaintances, the leaders of our congregation? What if we did that? You see, the Apostle Paul was able to stand up and say, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Why could he say that? Because he knew that he had a prayer team that was behind him praying on a regular basis for others. Sometimes you probably sit back and say, well, Brian, what would I say? Okay, God, protect all the pastors. Help my wife to be submissive. Obviously, I'm joking. I'm joking. Men, don't pray that prayer. Pray, help me to love my wife and lead my wife the way that I should. And if you'll do that, then she'll be submissive. Amen, ladies? Boy, not a single lady said amen with that. Man alive. I'm in trouble. How would you pray? The Bible gives ample prayers. Actually, you can just take verses and pray verses. Let me give you an example. Here in Philippians chapter 1, the Apostle Paul prays a great prayer for the Philippian believers. In Philippians chapter 1, beginning in verse 8, Paul says, for God is my witness, how I yearn for you all with the affection of Jesus Christ. And it is my prayer that your love may abound more and more with knowledge and all discernment, so that you may approve what is excellent and so be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Christ Jesus to the glory and praise of God. What if you prayed that prayer for your family every single day? Moms and dads, what if you prayed that prayer for your kids every single day? What if you prayed that prayer for your friends and acquaintances? Sometimes I wonder if our faith is anemic because our prayers are anemic. What if we truly prayed for one another? Mike would tell you, and I believe Mike was so cognizant of the fact that there were people all around the world praying for him. And much of Mike's confidence and much of Mike's courage came from the fact that he knew he was being lifted up in prayer. That's what the Apostle Paul says. Now, notice a second reason why the Apostle Paul could say, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Because Paul was assisted by the power of the Holy Spirit of God. And I would personalize that today. As a believer, you, like Paul, you, like Mike, are assisted by the Holy Spirit of God. Notice verse 19, Paul says, for I know that through your prayers, notice the next phrase, and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance. The word help in the passage literally means, it's the word from which we get our word supply. And here's what Paul is saying. Paul is saying, listen, I can do what I do. I can be successful. I can be victorious because it is the Holy Spirit of God who supplies me, who assists me, who helps me with everything that I need. Two thoughts I drew from that. If you're following along in your outlines, the first is this. The Holy Spirit is supplied to every single believer. Please catch that this morning. The Holy Spirit is applied or supplied to every believer. Notice Galatians chapter 3 and verse 5. We'll put it up on the screen this morning. Galatians chapter 3 and verse 5. Paul says this, but the fruit of the Spirit, does he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you do so by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? So Paul addresses the Galatians and says this, that the Holy Spirit of God who is supplied to you. Please catch that truth this morning. As a follower of Jesus Christ, you have been supplied by the Holy Spirit or with the Holy Spirit of God. Let me say that again today. I want that to sink into your mind, heart. As a follower of Jesus Christ, you have been supplied with the Holy Spirit of God. Paul says this, that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Doesn't matter how long you've been a believer. Doesn't matter whether you're a pastor or just a layperson. Doesn't matter if you're spiritual or whether you're carnal. It doesn't matter whether you've spent a lot of time reading your Bible this week or you've spent a little bit of time reading your Bible this week. It doesn't matter whether you've honored God this week or whether you haven't honored God this week. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, in you dwells the Holy Spirit of God. You have the power of the Holy Spirit living within you. God has supplied that to you. Paul says it this way in Romans chapter 8 and verse 9. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. In other words, if you sit back today and say, Brian, I don't think the Holy Spirit is indwelling me. I don't think I have the Holy Spirit. Well, catch this. You're not a believer then. You're not a follower of Jesus Christ. Because every follower of Jesus Christ has been fully, amply, and completely supplied with the Holy Spirit of God. You have just as much of Him as I do. Think of the most spiritual person that you know. Think of the most godly person that you know. You have just as much of the Holy Spirit as that person does. The idea is not that you have more of Him. Catch this, the idea is that He has more of you. That individual demonstrates godliness, not because they have more of the Holy Spirit, but that they submit and surrender themselves more to the Holy Spirit than maybe we do. Here's the second truth that I fleshed out. The Holy Spirit is not only supplied to every believer, but the Holy Spirit supplies every believer with everything he or she needs. He's the fuel of our fire. He is the faucet that turns on our water. He is the supply of everything we need. Vicky has built a fire pit out behind our house. Beautiful fire pit out behind our house, and in this time of year, we enjoy that fire pit. We like it when the weather goes down, you can go out and you can have a fire, and we can enjoy that fire. But in order for that fire, you don't just automatically light a match, and there's tons of fire, and that fire burns continually. What? You have to continually what? Supply wood on the fire. Last week, our family was here and Justin was here, and one night we had a fire. We're out back, and Justin designated himself as the person who would keep the fire going. All right, he didn't want anybody else to touch it. Nobody else could touch the stoker. Nobody else could do anything. He was the fire provider. And so every few minutes, he'd go get more logs, and he would put logs on the fire, and he would keep that fire going. He was the one that supplied the fuel for the fire to keep burning. That's what the Holy Spirit of God is to you. It's the job of the Holy Spirit to supply me and to supply you with everything we need for life and for godliness. It's His job. Galatians chapter 5, verse 23 says this, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. You might sit back and say, Brian, I'm naturally not a loving person. Don't worry about it. He supplies you with the love that you need. I'm naturally not a patient person. Don't worry. He supplies you with the patience that you need. But Brian, I have no self-control whatsoever. He supplies you with the self-control that you need. It's His fruit. It's His job to supply to you and I everything we need for life, for godliness, for ministry. Aren't you glad that God hasn't just commissioned us and left us out there on our own just to kind of fend for ourselves? God has not only saved us and called us, but He has given us everything we need. How could Mike, a boat builder, we've talked about that over and over, who was sent to the deserts of Africa, do everything God called him to do? Mike was a wonderful, terrific, godly man, but it wasn't Mike who did what Mike did. It was the power of the Holy Spirit of God who did it through him. And it's the power of the Holy Spirit of God who is enabling Amy today to continue with that ministry. So how can you stand and say, for me to live is Jesus Christ and to die is gain? You must be supported by the prayers of the saints. You must recognize and submit to the assistance, to the supply of the Holy Spirit of God in your life. How crazy would it be for you to call up the city one day and say, hey, I got no water in my house. I want water, but we have no water. And the city would say, well, you know, there's a valve outside your house. And all you have to do is go turn that valve on. No, I'm not going to turn that valve on, but I want water. And I want it right now. What do you have to do? You have to go out and make sure the valve is open. I'm not a plumber. If I'm not saying it correctly, plumbers, correct me afterward, all right? But I have been told that there's one of those valves outside our house, right? And when it opens up, what happens? Water flows in, all right? We have the power of the Holy Spirit of God at our disposition. We have all the love, all the patience, all the joy, all the kindness, all the temperance, everything we need to live. God's turned the valve on his end, but many times we don't receive that which God has freely made available to each and every one of us. So as a result, we struggle living for Christ. And we cannot even imagine the incomprehensible of sitting back and say, okay, I am ready to die. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Mike could, because he understood that. Let me show you a third truth in the passage. You and I can stand and say, for me to live is Christ, and die is gain, when we are driven by the desire to honor Jesus Christ. Notice in verse 20, Paul says this, as it is my eager expectation and hope. Let me just pause for a second and ask you today, what is your eager expectation? What is it that you are looking forward to, that you want more than anything else? You might sit back and say, Brian, I am holding on to vacation, right? In 6 weeks, I'm heading out on vacation, and that is my eager anticipation. Or you might sit back and say, 3 years to retirement. That's what I got. That's what I'm looking forward to. Or whatever it is, our high school students, you know what? Man, I'm looking forward to graduation. That is my eager expectation. Paul sat back and said that his eager expectation, his hope, that which drove him, was to not be ashamed. Paul was eagerly expecting to never live in a way that he would bring reproach to the cause of Jesus Christ. The phrase eager expectation speaks of a confident hope that God will bring everything to perfection. By the way, if you're familiar with Romans chapter 8, it's the exact same word that Paul uses when he talks about the creation is waiting with eager anticipation, with eager longing for the revelation of the sons of God. Paul was sitting back saying, listen, I am anticipating, I am eagerly expecting to not be ashamed. The word ashamed is an interesting word. It has the idea of dishonoring or disgracing. So here's what I want you to catch. It's in your outline. I really want you to catch this, okay? To Paul, the fear of dishonoring Jesus was greater than the fear of persecution. Catch that. The fear of dishonoring Jesus was greater for him than the fear of persecution. I think today we would We would kind of invert that just a little bit. I mean, if we lived in a violent society, and I know our society is becoming more and more violent, but if we lived in a violent society in which standing up for Jesus Christ constantly put us at risk, that might be the greatest fear of our lives. But Paul, who was writing this from prison, who was in the midst of being persecuted for his faith in Jesus Christ, sat back and said, listen, my greatest fear is not being persecuted. My greatest fear is living in such a way that Jesus Christ is not honored by my life, and I dishonor him. I bring disgrace to him. Listen, catch this today. Just as Jesus can be disgraced through cowardice, so Jesus can be magnified through unflinching courage. I would ask you today, which one of those two words best characterizes your walk and your service with the Lord? Would you use the word courage, or would you use the word cowardice? Which one of those two words? The Apostle Paul says, but that with full courage, now as always, Christ will be honored in my life, whether by life or whether by death. You see, we can confidently say, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain, when the driving passion of our life is to honor him. So, man, let me ask you a really, really penetrating question today. Don't lift your hand. Don't look at the person beside you. Don't elbow the person beside you. None of those things, all right? Don't give a dirty look to your spouse. None of those things. Let me ask you today, did you honor Jesus Christ this week? Or did you dishonor him? Was he magnified by your courage to stand up for him this week? Or was he dishonored by your cowardice? The Apostle Paul, who lived in a difficult world, said, listen, my eager expectation, my greatest fear is not that somebody's going to come in and take my life. It's not that I'm going to be arrested. My greatest fear is that in that process, I dishonor Jesus. And I do not want to do that. I've sat back and imagined many times what it was like the moment when Mike lost his life there at that cafe in Ouagadougou. We don't know the specifics. We'll probably never know the specifics of what happened. I think I know Mike well enough that Mike wasn't cowering behind a table. I really believe at some point Mike was defending someone. Who knows? Mike might have even been looking at the person who pointed a gun at him and quoting scripture to him. We don't know that. We'll know all of that when we get to heaven. But I do know this, at the crucial moment of Mike's life, Mike did not cower down, but with courage, he lived out that which he said in our pulpit just a few years ago, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Can you live like that? Mike lived like that, and God greatly used him. Let me mention a fourth thing in your notes today. You and I can stand and say, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain, when we are confident in the plan of God for your life. When you and I are confident that God has a specific plan for our lives. As Paul writes these words, he is not certain what God's plan was for him. He even vacillates in the passage. You saw it. He says, for you know what? I'm not sure what God is doing, whether God's going to have me keep living or whether God is going to take my life. And there's some ambiguity even in Paul's mind as he writes these words, what his future holds. Is Christ going to allow him to keep living and ministering, or whether Christ would be exalted through his death? Read the verses. Paul fleshes all of that out in the verses. But here's what Paul says. Either way, the Lord's will be done. And Paul is saying that God's will would be fully accomplished through his life. So I want to give you four really, really practical truths today that I would like you to chew on and kind of meditate on this week. And in just a few moments, we're going to have one of our men come and share a testimony as to how Mike impacted his life. But let me get you these four truths. They're in your outline. The first is this. The length and circumstances of your life are controlled by the sovereignty of God. The length and the circumstances of your life are controlled by the sovereignty of God. Notice a couple of verses, Matthew chapter 6 and verse 27. Jesus asked this question, and which of you by being anxious can add a single hour to his span of life? What's the idea? Worrying about your life will not make you live longer. Being anxious about your life will not make you live any longer. You can't add even an hour to your life by your anxiousness or even by your carefulness. That's what Jesus is saying. Hebrews 9:27, it is appointed for man to die once. Notice that phrase, it is appointed. God has appointed the time for you and I to die. We're not cats. We don't have nine lives. It's appointed for us to die one time. And after that comes the judgment. Think about that. What confidence that gives us to live and minister in some of the most difficult circumstances. How is Mike able to live and minister in a dangerous part of the world? Because Mike realized that the safest place for him to minister was right in the center of God's will. And no one was going to touch him. No one was going to affect him unless God allowed that to happen. And Mike did not submit to his own fears. He submitted to the sovereignty of Jesus Christ, and he trusted God to take care of his life, realizing that the light or the length and the circumstances of his life were already established by a sovereign God. That's not only true about Mike, but it's true about me, and it's true about you as well. Here's the second truth I pulled from that. While here, God has a plan and a purpose for your life. While you're here on this planet, God has a purpose for your life. And your purpose is not just to eat, drink, and to get married, all right? That's not your purpose. Your purpose is not to make as much money as you possibly can. God has a specific purpose for your life. It's easy for us to see that in a man like Mike Rittering. We can sit back and we say, man, can you see how God called him and lifted him out from his boat business and directed him to Africa? And now he's papa to hundreds of kids, and now he's ministering to widows, and he's digging wells all throughout West Africa. How cool is it that God had a purpose and a plan for Mike's life? Could we ever realize that God has just as much a purpose and a plan for your life and my life as he did for Mike Rittering? And his purpose for your life is just as powerful, and it's just as significant, and it's just as impactful as his purpose was for Mike as well. The psalmist said it this way in Psalm 37, verse 23, the steps of a good man are established by God. My steps are established by God. Your steps are established by God. God has a plan for your life. The world is filled with tragedies, is it not? The world is filled with horrific situations and circumstances that take place. But I submit to you this morning that one of the most tragic things in life is for an individual to live their life and not fulfill God's purpose. Not fulfill God's plan. Wake up, eat breakfast, go to work, make money, come home, go to bed, get up, eat breakfast, go to work, make money, come home, get up, eat breakfast, go to work, come home, watch TV, cheer for the Dolphins. Be disappointed with the Dolphins again. That's all part of the cycle of life, is it not? God has more than that for you. Amen. God has more than that for me. God has a purpose and a plan for your life. You see, when I sit back and say, for me to live is Christ, inerrant within that statement is the realization that I want to find out what that is. And I want to make sure that when I'm approaching the end of my life, I can look back and not say that I was perfect, not say that I dotted all of my I's and crossed my T's, but to be able to look back at the end of my life and say, as the Apostle Paul said, I fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. Man, we can say that about Mike. Can you say that about your life? Can you say right now that your life, wherever God has you in your work environment, and the idea is not that all of us pick up and move to Burkina Faso, West Africa. That's not the idea. The idea is not that all of us become pastors. That's not the idea. But God has a purpose for your life. God has you right where he has you. He's gifted you. He's given everything that you need so that you might serve him. While here on earth, however long that is, God has a purpose for your life. Here's the third thing. Your future with Christ is far better than anything this life has to offer. Paul actually says that in the passage. Let me find it, because he actually says that. In verse 23, he says, I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to be with Christ. And notice what he says, for that is far better. I don't know what your view of heaven is, but I guarantee you that everything God has for you in the future is better than anything this world has for us. And yet at times we want to dig roots so deep here and not realize that our home is in heaven. Here's the last thing, and I'm done. The last thing is this: make sure that your priority is to live in a manner worthy of the gospel. Notice verse 27, it's powerful. Paul starts a brand new paragraph and he says this, only. So having said all of that, for me to live as Christ and to die as gain, I'm not sure what God has for me, I'm ready to go. Paul looks to Philippians and he says, only. One commentator said that the word only is just like a finger that is pointing, indicating that Paul is saying something to you that is extremely important. Paul says, in the midst of everything you do, only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of you that you are standing firm in your faith. Make sure that your priority above all else is to live in a way that is worthy of the gospel. The Philippians understood that. The Philippians lived in the Roman Empire, and the Philippians realized that as Roman citizens, for some reason, they had rights that other Roman citizens did not have. The Philippians, the majority of them, had full citizen status. They were granted the privilege of special privileged citizenship. As a result of that, they were exempted from poll and land taxes, and they had great privileges. There was only one requirement. As a Roman citizen with all of those privileges, the requirement was this: they had to show loyalty and they had to show dedication to the emperor. That's what they were required to do. And so Paul, using citizenship terminology in this passage, looks at us, and the challenge that cries out is, we have been granted full citizenship in the kingdom of God. All of the rights and all the privileges as citizens of the kingdom, as children of God, as joint heirs with Jesus Christ, is ours. What does God in turn then ask of us? Only that your manner of life, the way you live, the way you think, the way you respond, what you do, only that your manner of life is what? Is worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Worthy of our emperor. Worthy of our king. Worthy of his kingdom. You see, when you live in that way, such a life lived in that way will impact others, and it will point others to the kingdom of God. Mike lived in that way. Mike impacted many of your lives. Many of you could stand up and give testimony today as to how Mike influenced your life. We don't have time for all of you to come up today. I'm gonna ask Matt Sinelli if Matt would come up. Matt's one of our young guys that has been greatly influenced by Mike, and I just asked Matt to share from his heart for just a moment how Mike influenced his life. Matt.
Thank you. I'm Matt Sinelli. I head up the men's ministry here, and I have the privilege of serving you men. And Pastor Brian asked me a few days ago if I can come up to share a little bit about what Mike has impacted my life. And it's funny is that after much prayer and, you know, consideration of what to say, and listening to Pastor Brian today, it's like a mirror of what God's put on my heart. So I really believe that if Mike was here today with us, I feel like these are the three points that he would like to hit on. And so the three points that I just feel like he would say is three things. Number one is legacy. Number two is calling. And number three is kingdom. And so the legacy, Pastor Alistair Begg says it this way: when you leave a room, you're leaving a legacy. And so the question is what legacy are you leaving? You know, we tend to think of legacy as something you kind of worry about when you get up there in age, or, you know, as your later years, you start focusing on that. But now's the time, no matter what life stage you're at, is legacy. And so Mike always impressed on my heart the legacy of loving others unconditionally. You know, he never had a reservation about anybody, anything. You know, you ask him about certain things and he was just like, always goes right back to Christ. What does Christ say about this situation? Another thing is perspective that Mike has always taught me about is, what are you looking at and what is God looking at? What is concerning to God and what is concerning to you? Are they matching up or are they different? I was just talking to another brother earlier. You know, your perspective in the valley is so much more different than on the mountaintop. And so what is your perspective on your life and how you're living it? And the other thing that Mike has challenged me with is calling. You know, how many times have you heard Mike, or through this message, what are you afraid of? What is making you grip your seat and not getting up and moving forward? What is that? Do you know that that is not from God? That is from the enemy. He's telling you a lie, and you're believing it. And so if Mike was here, I really believe Mike would say, you need to throw that fear away. You need to step up to the pulpit here. You need to grab the baton and move forward. What are you afraid of? Your calling. Matthew 28:19-20, Jesus says, go out and make disciples. That's not a negotiable thing. You can't come to God and say, well, but that's only for some people. For me, I come here and I, you know, come to church. That's not what Christ died for. Christ died so that you would go out and make disciples. How are you doing with that area? No matter what life stage you're at, whether you're a teenager or whether you're up there in years, you can disciple anybody and anybody around you. The last point is kingdom, okay? What are you building in life? What are you investing in life? Your time, your money, your brain power. What's important? Like, what are you thinking about right now? I know you're not listening to me, but what are you thinking about right now? Are you building and investing in that and not in the kingdom of Christ? Mike would say, stop wasting your time down here. Stop wasting your time in your business and your work. We're not asking you to quit your job and just start carrying a cross down full 41. That's not what we're asking you to do. We're asking you to start tuning into the right station. You know, the old analog stations, how you're just a little bit over and it's, you know, but you go right over and you can hear clearly what God is telling you. What is God telling you? Jesus' view of his kingdom, John 18:36, my kingdom is not of this world. That's a quote from Christ. My kingdom is not of this world. What are you building? What are you investing? Is it in this world or is it the kingdom to come? And so that is the call. Is the call is to do a self-examination of your own heart. Where are you at with that? Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That is the mantra of Christ right there. That's what he was trying to tell us. Seek him first. Don't seek your wealth. Don't seek your retirement plan. Don't seek, you know, the things that are so important on this earth. Yes, God may be calling you to do those things now, but what is the end game plan? If Mike was here, these were the two quotes that, and he actually quoted this. This is a quote from Mike. But God has an amazing retirement plan in heaven. So you don't have to focus on your retirement plan down here. You don't have to focus on your 401k and your stocks and whatever else, you know, real estate, whatever you're into, or you're just trying to go to college. Don't focus on those things. If God is calling you out of that, if he's pulling you out of your seat, you need to respond. The last one is this, and I was just listening to a message of his, was I feel, and I agree with this, but I feel like we make God too small in our world. I think when we think of God, we think of, okay, God, yes, I feel like you're calling me to do this, but you got to show up big, right? It's like almost kind of we say that. So then the opposite would be that we think God's too small. We're asking him to show up big, but God is already big. And so Mike always challenged me with that is, how is God in your perspective, in your world? Is he big or small? And if he's big, what are you afraid of? What's holding you back? You know, do we have to have Christ come back down and die on the cross a second time to die for that thing you're afraid of? No, that's blasphemy. That's heresy. So what are you afraid of? I want to challenge everybody here, okay? If God is calling you to something, would you approach Pastor Brian, elders, deacons, even myself, say, listen, I feel like God is calling me in this area. We would love to pray for you and help you, you know, with God, give you that vision, give you that plan. We're asking you to step up. That's what we're asking you to do. It's no longer come to church on Sunday, take up a seat, go home, have lunch, talk, man, that was a great message, Pastor Brian. Go on Facebook and praise him up and everything. No, man, what are we doing here? What are we doing? So these are the points that God has put on my heart. I wanted to share those with you. And the last one, and I'll give it to Pastor Brian, is my favorite quote of Mike Rittering is, sometimes God looks down on me and chuckles. So that is by far the funniest thing that I've ever heard Mike say. And it puts the humanness of who he is, but it shows us and points us to Jesus Christ, who's the most important.
Matt, appreciate you. Thank you. So I don't think Matt is saying that you got to go cash in your 401k today, huh? The idea is this, what are you living for? You can start out small. Mike started out, first thing Mike did at Hollywood Community Church was he cut the grass on the football fields because he realized that the grass needed cut and nobody was cutting the grass. I'll do that. Then we needed a youth worker. Nobody was doing it. Mike said, I'm not a youth worker, but I'll do it. The simple truth is this, God has something that he wants you to do. And if all of us would just step up and say, okay, God, here I am. Use me. For me to live is Jesus Christ. To die is gain. I view Mike as a modern day hero. I view Mike as a modern day martyr. We haven't had any martyrs in our country for many years. The last one would have been in the 50s. Jim Elliot, who gave his life along with a few others down in South America for the Aka Indians. Jim Elliot made this statement, and I close with this statement. Jim Elliot said, he is no fool who gives up that which he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. Mike freely let go of the things that he couldn't keep, but Mike gained so much that for all of eternity, he will not lose. So my question is this, who's the next Mike Rittering? Who's the next Paul that would just step up and say, God, I have no idea what you have for me. I'm not quitting my job. I'm not I'm not moving to Africa, but God, here I am. I want you to use me. And if you'll put yourself in that position, there's no limit to what God can do through you.